dozen miles east of Bend is a wilderness area with a little over 30,000 acres, consisting of ancient basalt lava flows, twisted old-growth western junipers, abandoned pioneer homesteads, and dry riverbeds. Because it is so rugged and arid, having no surface water at all, it was called by early settlers the Badlands. Hello, I'm John Garvin, and I'd like to welcome you to another episode in my series on oil painting. Today, I'm going to be exploring a subject I discovered by pure chance. I've been to the Badlands many times. It's low enough in elevation that though it gets dusted with snow from time to time, it's pretty much accessible all year. A few years ago, I stumbled across something completely unexpected. Near its western border, but still in the middle of harsh Badlands, I discovered a lush green oasis, a 12-acre pond surrounded by tall willow trees, cattails, and other tall reeds, filled with sunfish, largemouth bass, brown bullheads, and home to flocks of ducks and geese. Nothing could have looked more out of place. In fact, if I hadn't been staring right at it, I would have thought it impossible. That is, until I learned a surprising fact. Just 30 years ago, none of this existed. The pond began life as a wastewater holding pond built by an early homesteader named William H. Reynolds, which is where the lake gets its name from. In 1989, the Deschutes County, the Bureau of Land Management, and community volunteers decided to turn that tiny pond into a recreation area, rebuilding the entire pond from scratch. They created the islands, placed rocks, planted trees, the reeds, the grasses, and they basically transformed the desert into an oasis. Today, it's a little hard to believe that the pond hasn't always been here. It really is an oasis set in the middle of harsh Badlands. Though Highway 20 is only a few miles away, it is quiet and serene here. If you stand still and listen, all you'll hear are the swaying of willow branches in the wind, the cries of distant waterfowl, and the quiet sounds of ripples spreading across the water. It's the water, in fact, that inspired my next painting. I love how still the pond's surface can be, like a mirror reflecting the sky, the grasses along its shore, and the willow trees that droop over it as if their branches were desperately grasping for water. This time of year, it's even more spectacular because the greens have all transformed into rich reds, oranges, and rust-colored browns, which contrast nicely with the sky's stormy grays and the water's muddy blues. It's a combination of contrasting colors that I haven't painted before, and I'm excited to give it a try. I'm going to call this one simply Fall at Reynolds Pond. In previous episodes, I've talked about my process for transferring an image to Masonite and doing a full underpainting to establish light and dark values. So I'm going to skip over those steps for this episode and jump right into the painting. In the last episode, I mentioned that I discovered the work of Roger Bansomer and how he paints using a very limited palette. Today, I'm using titanium white, cad yellow, Windsor blue, alizarin crimson, and just a dab of permanent rose. I also decided not to start with a fresh palette sheet because I had already mixed a bunch of great colors from my last painting. So after adding a bit of fresh white and mixing in a warm gray, I'm ready to start. I like starting with lighter colors because they go in almost transparent layers, letting the underpainting do most of the work. Next, I mix up a dark orange using yellow, alizarin crimson, and blue, and begin to block in the shapes of the trees. Note how thin these layers of paint are. At this point, I'm not worried about their final color or even their final shape. I'm just trying to better define the overall mass of leaves. For the reflections, I mix a slightly lighter orange because I know that eventually the trees are going to be much lighter than they are now. My goal here is to just get some color on the Masonite so I can begin to judge how saturated I want them all to be. I like to pick out certain details as I go, like the surface of this island, because it helps to know early on where I'm going to emphasize areas of light and shadow. Once the paint sets up a bit, I mix an even lighter orange and start adding detail to the trees. At this scale, it's impossible to paint individual leaves, and I don't want that anyway. All I'm trying to do is capture an impression of their overall shape and color. This isn't impressionism with a capital I, but more of an impressionistic realism. I don't want to be photorealistic, but impression realistic. Next, I mix blue and alizarin crimson together to create a dark brown, and I start working on the branch structures. I use a lot of turpentine in this mixture so the paint goes on smoothly and quickly. To get these very fine lines just takes a steady hand. The branches don't have to be perfect because any place I mess up, I'll just cover up later on with more leaves. For the background trees, I add just a little yellow so I end up with a really dark green and begin painting them in using the same double-lot brush. You can see how I start with the basic shape defined in the underpainting, but then refine them by adding branches and other details. While I'm at it, I use the same mix to add detail to the pond's shoreline, shadow areas beneath the distant trees, and more detail to the reflections in the water. Going back to my warm white mixture, I now start adding more detail to the trees by adding negative spaces where the sky can be seen through the masses of leaves. Hopping down to the water, I work on the reflection some more, better defining the shape of the island. Then back up to the trees, adding more negative space so we can see a bit of the sky along the horizon. At this point, I'm jumping all over the painting. More work on the reflections, more work on the trees, and adding in some wispy clouds. Once I'm happy with the midground, I go back to the dark colors I used for the branches and begin blocking in the grassy area in the foreground. Again, this doesn't have to be pretty or all that accurate even, because this will almost be completely covered with the lighter blades of grass that I'll paint in later. Next, I throw a bit of color in, trying to capture that sense of thin, wispy reeds. Then go back to the dark brown to put in some heavier branches. For the grass, I use the bent blade grass technique I've used in a few other paintings now, working light over dark, adding more and more layers using slightly different colors. Then more detail work. I add lights and darks to the sky and more negative space to the trees, refining their mass and shape. Then, as always, I add my signature, putting it in a spot in the lower right corner where it won't interfere with any important details. And with that, I'm done, right? Well, usually. This time, I felt like something was a little off. So I asked my girlfriend what she thought, and she pointed out a few issues. The sky didn't look done to her, the grass wasn't quite right, and the water was still too gray. After letting the painting sit for a couple of days, I realized she was absolutely right. The good news is that because the painting was now completely dry, I could add these fixes and more finishing touches, mostly with glazes. There were two main issues with the grassy foreground. There wasn't enough color, and the individual blades of grass were too distinct. To fix this, I went in with a muddy orange glaze and just worked it over the entire area, adding Windsor blue for more shadow in the darker areas. The other issue is that there just wasn't enough specific detail. Going back to the photo, I realized I hadn't added any of these highlights. The dead flowers, the dry reeds, and the bits of straw here and there. Next, I mixed a dab of that permanent red into my oranges and went back to work on the trees. I had three goals here: to add more color to them, to further refine their shapes, and to glaze over a lot of the existing detail. I wanted them to look more like they would if you were squinting your eyes. You can still see areas of light and shadow, but leaves and the branch structures become more blurred. Next, using lots of medium, I mixed a super thin glaze of pale green and worked back over the shadow parts of the pond surface. This not only made the pond more realistic, but the subtle greens contrast nicely with the surrounding yellows and oranges. Once I was done with the pond surface, I realized there was still more I could do with the grass. I added more dead flowers and dry reeds to the left side here, even though they weren't in the photo, because it helped balance the composition and added more interest. The last thing I tackled was the sky. My main goals here were to add more color and to refine the shapes of the clouds, again adding more interest. I started by adding just a touch of cad yellow to my warm white and created a much warmer sky toward the horizon, adding yellow to the reflections as well. Then I warmed up the shadow areas using a bit more alizarin crimson and blue, refining areas of light and dark and adding more structure to the clouds. Using that same shadow mixture, I go back to the horizon and add more distant layers of clouds. This not only adds detail and interest, but pushes the horizon back considerably. The last thing I work on is just refining the clouds towards the top of the painting, adding warmth and color to the shadow areas and more detail to the areas where light and dark intersect. And with that, the painting is finally done. I usually don't ask others for their opinions on my work, but this time I'm really glad I did. The revisions took less than an hour and made the final painting so much better than it would have been. The lesson that I relearned here, because I already knew this, is that sometimes it's good to have an extra pair of eyes that can spot things you might be too close to see.
So for a painting like this, it's entirely possible to spend hours and hours and hours noodling over every detail. Another one of the things I learned from Roger Bansomer in watching his painting show is that sometimes you're just better off knowing when to call it quits. And even though this painting could probably still use some more work, I'm going to call it good and move on to the next one. So that's it for this episode. If you liked it, please think about subscribing, hit that like button, and I'll see you next time on Oil Painting with John Garvin.